Okay, let's read from the Resurrection and the Hereafter. We are reading from the words. The name of the book is The Words. And the writer of the book is Bediuzzaman Said Nursi. This is from Risale-i Nur Collection. Bediuzzaman Said Nursi is an Islamic scholar from Turkey. And this part that we are reading is about the Resurrection and the Hereafter. The tenth word, actually. Let's read. Note. The reasons for my writing these treatises in the form of metaphors, comparisons, and stories are to facilitate comprehension and to show how rational, appropriate, well-founded, and coherent are the truths of Islam. So it is in the shape of metaphors, actually. There are comparisons and analogies in these kinds of examples. The meaning of the stories is contained in the truths that conclude them. Each story is like an allusion pointing to its concluding truth. Therefore, they are not mere fictitious tales, but veritable truths. It begins with a verse from Quran. In the name of God, the merciful, the compassionate. Look then to the signs of God's mercy, how he restores life to the earth after its death. Verily, he it is who quickens the dead, for he is powerful over all things. This is from chapter 30, verse number 50. Brother, if you wish for a discussion of resurrection and the hereafter in simple and common language, in a straightforward style, then listen to the following comparison together with my own soul. Once, two men were traveling through a land as beautiful as paradise. By that land, we intend the world. Looking around them, they saw that everyone had left open the door of his home and his shop and was not paying attention to guarding it. Money and property were readily accessible without anyone to claim them. One of the two travelers grasped hold of all that he fancied, stealing it and usurping it. Following his inclinations, he committed every kind of injustice and abomination. None of the people of that land moved to stop him, but his friend said to him, "What are you doing? You will be punished, and I will be dragged into misfortune along with you. All this property belongs to the state. The people of this land, including even the children, are all soldiers or government servants. It is because they are at present civilians that they are not interfering with you. But the laws here are strict. The king has installed telephones everywhere, and his agents are everywhere. Go quickly and try to settle the matter." But the empty-headed man said in his obstinacy, "No, it is not state property. It belongs instead to some endowment and has no clear or obvious owner. Everyone can make use of it as he sees fit. I see no reason to deny myself the use of these fine things. I will not believe they belong to anyone unless I see him with my own eyes." He continued to speak in this way with much philosophical sophistry, and an earnest discussion took place between them. So in most of the cases, we face this claim, right? Unless I see him with my own eyes. So when we talk about God, most of our friends, maybe sometimes, we face them. They say that I don't believe unless I see him with my own eyes, right? First, the empty-headed man said, "Who is the king here? I can't see him." And then his friend replied, "Every village must have its headman. Every needle must have its manufacturer and craftsman. And as you know, every letter must be written by someone." Right? When we see a letter or a book, for example, we know that there is a writer. if there is an art of especially, you know. As you know, every letter must be written by someone. How then can it be that so extremely well ordered a kingdom should have no ruler? And how can so much wealth have no owner? When every hour a train arrives filled with precious and artful gifts, as if coming from the realm of the unseen. Every hour a train, there is a footnote for this term, every hour a train, indicates the cycle of a year. Indeed, every spring is a carload of provisions coming from the realm of the unseen. So every spring actually, you know, every winter, at each season, there is another type of food actually coming from the unseen, you know, from the tree, which is made of wood, which drinks water and eats soil, gives us the food. So it is coming from the unseen actually, you know, every season has a different type of food. It's like a train, you know. How can so much wealth have no owner? When every hour a train arrives filled with precious and artful gifts, as if coming from the realm of the unseen. And all the announcements and proclamations, all the seals and stamps found on all those goods, all the coins and the flags waving in every corner of the kingdom. So there are signatures of the kingdom. When we look around, there are signatures of the kingdom, like coins, like flags. So on all those goods, all the coins and the flags waving in every corner of the kingdom, can they be without an owner? It seems you have studied foreign languages a little and are unable to read this Islamic script. In addition, you refuse to ask those who are able to read it. Come now, let me read to you the king's supreme decree. The empty-headed man then retorts, well, let us suppose there is a king. What harm can he suffer from the minute use I am making of all his wealth? Will his treasury decrease on account of it? In any event, I can see nothing here resembling prison or punishment. His friend replied, this land that you see is a maneuvering ground. It is, in addition, an exhibition of his wonderful royal arts. Then again, it may be regarded as a temporary hospice, one devoid of foundations. Do you not see that every day one caravan arrives as another departs and vanishes? It is being constantly emptied and filled. Soon, the whole land will be changed, its inhabitants will depart for another and more lasting realm. There, everyone will be either rewarded or punished in accordance with his services. That treacherous, empty-headed one retorted rebelliously, I don't believe it. Is it at all possible that a whole land should perish and be transferred to another realm? So this is the belief of resurrection and hereafter actually, right? Is it at all possible that a whole land should perish and be transferred to another realm? His faithful friend then replied, since you are so obstinate and rebellious, come, let me demonstrate to you, with 12 out of the innumerable proofs available, that there is a supreme tribunal, a realm of reward and generosity, and a realm of punishment and incarceration, and that just as this world is partially emptied every day, so too a day shall come when it will be totally emptied and destroyed. So this 10th word is consisting of 12 aspects and 12 truths, and this is just a small introduction actually for the comparison. We will read the first aspect and the first truth, which is corresponding to the first aspect. It is about the name of sustainer. It's a name of God, you know. The gate of dominicality and sovereignty. the manifestation of the name of sustainer. Let's read the first aspect and the first truth, and we will finalize at this point. Is it at all possible that in any kingdom, and particularly so splendid a kingdom as this, there should be no reward for those who serve obediently and no punishment for those who rebel? So in a kingdom, we see that there is reward for the ones who serve obediently. You know, if we assume a king, you know, and no punishment for those who rebel. Let's assume that there is a king and he wants something from a servant. If the servant does not do what he orders and insults instead to the king, of course there is going to be a punishment, right? In a kingdom, even if we assume these states, you know, we have in the current time, like the democracies, when someone insults to the king, or let's say not king, but the government officials, like the rulers, like the presidents, of course there's going to be a punishment. Reward and punishment are virtually non-existent here. There must therefore be a supreme tribunal somewhere else. First truth, the gate of dominicality and sovereignty, the manifestation of the name of sustainer. Is it at all possible that the glory of God's dominicality and his divine sovereignty should create a cosmos such as this, in order to display his perfections with such lofty aims and elevated purposes, without establishing a reward for those believers who through faith and worship respond to these aims and purposes, or that he should not punish those misguided ones who treat his purposes with rejection and scorn? So if we look at the universe, it's like a kingdom, right? So there will be reward for the ones who show obedience, you know. So the lawmaker, actually, in summary, the lawmaker will force the guys to abide by the rules of the law, right? If the ones who do not obey the rules and violate them, there will be punishment, of course. So this first truth is finished, actually. So we will finalize at this point. The second truth is about the generosity and mercy, and we will read that in the next time. So subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal alimul hakim wa akhir da'wahum alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin al-fatiha.